You'll see him do that one live tonight at Turning Stone. Roger Hodgson and Supertramp there. Classic Rock, TK99 and TK105, 3 o'clock Rock Block, brought to you by Dunkin' Donuts today. I'm Rick Deyulio. You know what? I just happened to have on the phone with me the guy who's playing at Turning Stone tonight, the voice of Supertramp, the legendary Roger Hodgson. Roger, thanks for calling today. It's great to talk with you.
Rick, it's a pleasure to be with you.
Your tour is called the Breakfast in America Tour. How's it going so far?
Well, it's been going fantastically. The reason I'm calling it the Breakfast in America Tour was probably I was listening to your introduction, and you know, you said the name Roger Hodgson, and a lot of people probably don't know who Roger Hodgson is, and so it's ironic to have a name that people don't recognize, even though they'll recognize my voice and obviously the songs I've written for the band Supertramp. So really, calling the tour Breakfast in America really was a way to help connect the dots for people, because people are coming to the show and just getting blown away. I mean, people who saw Supertramp in their heyday are saying, wow, this was like going to a Supertramp show, but maybe even better. And they'll be hearing a lot of the songs that I wrote with the band, the Logical song, Dreamer, Take the Long Way Home, Breakfast in America, Give a Little Bit.
There are times when all the world's asleep, the questions run so deep for such a simple man. These are some really very profound lyrics. And You wrote these when you were young. You were 17, 18, maybe 19 years old. How does a kid that age write something so profound and write melodies that are so complex?
For me, music was really where I went to bare my soul. I wasn't writing. I wasn't playing for anyone else. It was something I had to do when I was alone, and it was really where I went to express my joy, my pain, my confusion, my longing for love, my deep desire to know God and understand what and who God was. And so these songs, many of them kind of almost like prayers, songs that people think maybe are a song from between a boy and a girl, often are me just really crying out for connection to God in some way. You know, the Logical song, obviously, the key to that song is, please tell me who I am.
The story about when you released your second solo album and you had suffered at about the same time the album came out, you'd suffered a bad fall and suffered severe injuries to your wrists. And you were told by physicians that you would never play again. Do you talk to fans all the time that take inspiration from that?
I think it's a story that does inspire people. I think any story of overcoming a life-threatening challenge or something like that, that always has the capacity to inspire. I know I've been inspired by other people's stories. For me, obviously, smashing my wrist into 100 pieces and having the doctor say, well, that's it for your musical career, you won't play again, obviously had a profound impact on me. But, you know, I also really believe that when wake-up calls come like that, they come for reasons. Yes, I had to really fight hard to reclaim the use of my wrists, but I learned a lot from that experience, and I really believe that it even happened because I'd gone off. I'd lost my way, and it was really life's way, God's way of saying, hey, you know, this, the ability to make music is going to be taken away from you unless you get back on remembering where your gift's coming from.
What was the thought process that went into creating the album cover for Breakfast in America? It's an iconic cover.
Well, it I think more than anything, it really captured the mood of the album. I think Breakfast in America is a very uplifting, warm album. Maybe even though it had some serious lyrical content, it didn't overall, the musically, it didn't sound as serious as maybe some of our former albums. And the biggest thing actually was the waitress. We were working with an art director, and he brought his first suggestions for a waitress were younger, sexier, you know, showing a lot of bust, and he said, no, that's just not us. That just isn't what we want. So we looked through a model agency book, and we found Libby, who was the lady on the cover, which is a kind of middle-aged lady, but with a real twinkle.
Right.
And that was the cream on the on the cake, if you like.
Now, is Libby still, I mean, is she still with us? Do you know anything about her nowadays, or?
We stayed in touch for a while, but not nowadays.
No, okay.
But she was a wonderful lady.
Something like Give a Little Bit, it has to make you feel good that a song like that was used as the soundtrack to a commercial for Super Bowl 47. And then NFL.com, the viewers or the users of NFL.com voted the number one commercial in the Super Bowl that year. As the guy that wrote that, it has to make you feel good.
Well, it does feel good to have a purpose in a way, because these songs really do have such a strong connection to so many people in the world. And so it's amazing to play these songs and look out and see people crying or hugging each other, or, you know, to see all those reactions. And then also to see a lot of young people, too, who are maybe who are discovering these songs and realizing that music can have more of a depth than a lot of the music that is popular today.
Well, Roger, you're playing tonight at Turning Stone. Still are some tickets available for the show in the showroom. Can't wait to see you. I'll be there. Really, have a great show. We're looking forward to seeing it.
Great, Rick. I'll see you at the show then.